Hello everyone, good morning. Thank you once again for being with us today. Today, teacher Anna Bello will be presenting active listening and cultural awareness in the English classroom. Well, let me tell you something about teacher Anita Bello. Anna Bello is a graduated linguist specialized in English language from Universidad Mayor de San Andrés. Currently, she works as an English teacher at Centro Boliviano Americano. Anita teaches beginning to advanced levels. She has also worked with primary and secondary school, receiving a rewarding experience. She has cursed several courses and workshops to increase her professional development. She believes that study, preparation, and hard work are the doors to a world of opportunities. Anita lives in La Paz, and during her free time, she loves to travel and spend time with her family and pets. Welcome, dear Anita. Happy to have you today.
Thank you so much, José Manuel. Well, it's a pleasure for me to be here. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Well, the audience is all yours.
Thank you so much. Great. Well, let's start. Please, yeah, you can see my presentation. Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. We're talking about active listening and cultural awareness in our English classroom. Let me please show you. This is part of what I learned in this open course, so I want to share my knowledge, but a little bit of what I learned previously. Let me show you, please, the topics we're checking today. I will see the 7 active listening techniques, okay? And we're using these techniques for everything, every activity that we complete in our classroom, we can apply it. We're talking about cultural awareness. Yeah, let's continue talking about culture and microcultures and the identity. Well, I will show you 2 activities that you can apply in your class. So let's start, please. Right. Okay. Look at this. Stephen said that most people do not listen with the intent to understand. They listen with the intent to reply. And this happens in our classrooms. Sometimes we just ask students, what do you think? What do you think? What do you think? Like we just need to receive any kind of answer. But it's very important to interact. Very important to understand what the other person is trying to say. And that's active listening. Let me please show you. We're using active listening to reply, right, correctly, right, to create a meaningful conversation. That's very important. We can use active listening business, counseling and training, conflict resolution, and also education. I consider that we can use active listening anytime, okay? Anytime, even when we are talking with someone at home. It's very important to make the other person feel good, right? And important. That's the key here. Active listening has 7 techniques. Let me show you. We can use these techniques not only for listening, only also when we read. Use your full attention to read the post, reflect before responding, make sure you understood what the other person said. Recognize the emotional side, offer alternatives, share your point of view, and request for more information. Let's see one by one. And we can use these techniques in our class. Remember that the first thing and our objective in our class when we have speaking activities, we have to make our students feel confident. They have to feel they can more, they can give you more, they can say more. Many students are very shy and they don't want to participate, they don't want to mention things, they just mention some sentences sometimes, and that's not good. We have to try to make them say more and more, depending on the level, of course, but let's try and let's give them confidence, a lot of confidence. The first technique that we are using is use your full attention. Use your full attention. That's very important. When we ask our students to share something, we have to pay all of our attention. Pay all the attention and avoid distractions and avoid checking your cell phone, for example, or listening to the others or having another conversation. That's not good. If it's necessary, right, we can ask for clarification. This is the first technique, and as you can see, it's very simple. The only thing we have to do is to fully understand, clear our mind in order to get all the things they are mentioning. Our second technique is to reflect before responding. Okay. Being an active listener requires self-awareness. We have to fully understand what the other person is saying in order to reply. Reflect before you answer. So let's think about the way we are responding. Is it meaningful what I'm going to say? Is it necessary to mention this information? Did I understand what the other person said? Everything is important. So we have to reflect before we answer. And our reactions must be helpful, okay? If we are not contributing something to the conversation, it's better not to say it. So what judgments are we making? We have to think about it. What are going to be our reactions? We have to think if what we are going to say is helpful or not. Think about your immediate reactions. So yeah, just take some seconds before reply to the other person. Our third technique is make sure you understood. Sometimes we are very distracted or something that the other person said is not so clear. So we can ask some questions. Or maybe we're not sure about what the other person is mentioning. So we can ask some questions, okay? Or maybe we're worried that the other person may not be receptive to what you want to say. So it's necessary to clarify, okay? Be careful how you express what you want to say. Clarify asking some questions, right? Do you mean that? Correct me if I'm wrong. You can restate as well, right? You can restate or summarize what the other person mentioned previously in order to make sure if you really understood so we can answer correctly. Then we can use expressions like this. Let's see if I'm clear about this. let me see if I completely understood. Do you mean this? Do you mean that? We can ask these kind of questions. This kind of interaction is very important. Not only receiving, we can interact a little bit with our students so we can give them that confidence that they need in order to produce even more. That's a clue here. So we can ask many questions. Are you saying that? I'm not certain I understand or I understood. Do you mean this? Do you mean that? We can ask them. Correct me if I'm wrong. We can use these kind of phrases. And of course, this is going to be helpful for them to produce even more and to think more. Our fourth technique is to recognize the emotional side. And for me, this is one of the most important techniques because this technique helps us to connect with our students. When our students feel connected and confident, of course, they are going to produce more. They are going to say more. Some of them are very shy, and it's very difficult for them to open to the class and mention some things. It's very difficult for them. So what we have to do is to give them confidence, right? Try to make them feel comfortable in class. Even if they make mistakes, no problem, right? Sometimes it's not necessary to correct them all the time. So if they open, they can mention. So if they mention if they share their emotions, it's going to be very good for us, right, at the end, because they produce more and they learn more, of course. The emotional side, I consider, is important because they can connect. We can connect with them. Of course, this is going to be emphatic listening. We will recognize the emotional impact, right? And especially when students share their experiences or their emotions, is where we can use this technique. We can use some expressions in order to interact, like, I understand how it feels, right? That sounds really nice, right? It sounds scary, it sounds frustrating, exciting, it sounds really important to you. And even in this case, we can share more. We can even also share our own experiences in order to connect and to make the other person feel understood. So that's the emotional side that we have to take into account. Let's make feel our students important, right? Try to avoid hurting feelings. That's something we have to do. So we have to use the previous techniques, right? Reflect before answering. The next one is offer alternatives. Here is where we can share, right, our things with some of our experiences or knowledge with our students too. Check for understanding. Check for understanding, take others' ideas further. We can give them more possibilities if they are mentioning or they are reporting about something or they forgot something. Let's say we can help them and give them more alternatives when they are reporting, when they are mentioning something. Conduct to a new direction. That it's possible to do that. Would you agree with this idea? We can say, is it possible that, I wonder if, and give them more possibilities. And this is going to make our conversation even longer. And of course, they will analyze more and measure more, of course. The next technique, the sixth one, is share your point of view, knowledge, or experience. Here we have to be careful because we have to reflect before. We want to share some things that we know and they can be very helpful. for the conversation, for the interaction, but be careful with the things you want mentioning. Of course, remember you have to be very humble when you share, right? We don't want to show up. We don't want the students to think that they are wrong. So we can say some more things, right? I have also experienced this when, right? This happened to me. Your post remind me of, right? I noticed that, right? We can mention more things. It happened to me, right? We can share our experience. We can contribute with our knowledge. And also we can give our point of view. Of course, remember that we have to be very respectful when we share what we think. And the last technique is request more information. When we're not really sure, we can ask. Right? We can ask the students or well, the person we're talking with. About more information, we can ask more information in order to get deeper information, and also in order to understand and make the discussion more meaningful. Says we can ask, right? I'm curious about what you said. Can you tell me more? What do you think would happen if we can ask more things in order to make our conversation meaningful and richer, of course. What do you think would happen if you, right, we can give them even possibilities? That's important. We have these techniques. We can use many of them. You can use one technique, two techniques, depending, of course, depending what the other person is saying, but no matter what technique you use, remember that you have to be very respectful. When you give your opinion, you have to be honest and open. I recommend these techniques. They were really helpful. I used them, and it helped me. This active listening helped me to connect with my students. At the beginning, they were very shy, but when we involve with all the things they are mentioning, eventually they open and mention more things. They practice their speaking more, and that's what we want, right? They want students produce. It's a good technique that you can use. Well, techniques, actually. Great. Let's apply these techniques all the time. Not only in class, I recommend you to apply them at home, everywhere. Let's change a little bit. And of course, we can use these techniques with the activities that I will show you right now. Here we have a question. Now let's please move to the second topic that we have. Culture. And previously we saw a presentation about culture. But let me ask you this question. It's going to be very quickly. What are the first things you think when you listen to the word culture? I would like to ask you, what are the first things you think when you listen to the word culture? What do you think? I'm not sure if I have an answer. Traditions is well, food. Great, thank you so much. Traditions, languages, traditions, food, profession, customs. Yes, you're right. The first things that come to our mind when we think about culture are food, clothes, music, social relationships, values. And it's okay, right? Actually, that's culture. That's culture. And that's what we have to include in our classroom. Cultural awareness is very important because, of course, we are part of our one culture, at least one culture. And students, as they are learning another language, they have to learn about other language, other cultures. Sorry, but they have to be aware of their own culture. Right? That's the starting point. Cultural awareness. Hey, this is our next topic. Let me please show you. When we think about culture, as you mentioned, right? Generally, we think about food, traditions, all that stuff, but culture goes deeper. When we learn a language, we can explore many dimensions. Sorry, teachers can raise students' awareness of cultural differences that we generally try to apply in our class. However, it's very important for students to learn about their own culture. We're members of at least one culture. And when we know more about our culture, we can make better connections with other cultures. So we have to identify who we are first. We can help our students to raise their awareness in class. Okay? We can make our students reflect about the factors that influence our culture, our traditions, our values. About our own culture, we can show some elements to others, and we can compare cultures. If we don't know our own culture, it's not possible to make comparisons, right? So here we have some elements of culture that we can apply in our class. This is the 3P model of culture. We have the perspectives. And the perspective is what we generally see, what we don't see well, what members of a culture think, value, and feel. And this is more difficult to identify. I will show you some examples. The practices, the way members communicate and interact with one another. And the products is what you mentioned, what members create, share, and transmit to next generations. Products are the easier one to identify because we can see them, we can hear, we can taste even food. Right, you know, that's the first thing. It refers to technology, to food, clothing. But perspectives and practices are not easy to identify. They tend to be firmly held in a society, and they are considered elements of a deep culture. In order to identify the elements of culture, we can use the iceberg analogy. And this is the first activity that you can use with your students. When we see this picture, we see this iceberg, but we just see the surface. But deeply inside, we have more. And culture is that way. Edward Hall suggests this iceberg analogy. And this is an activity. Let's identify first. As you can see the iceberg, we have the surface culture, what we can see, And they are the products. If we see the three P elements of culture, the products are the things that we can see, we can listen. We have food, customs, music, dance, traditions. Practically everything that we generally mention with our students in class, right? National customs, traditional music, dance, literature, holidays, everything is there in the products. Then we have the surface, subsurface culture. Here we have the practices. And as I mentioned before, they are not so easy to identify. Here we have body language, gestures, behavior, social interaction, notions of courtesy, even eye contact. And this subsurface culture differs from culture to culture. Imagine if we compare Japanese culture with our culture, eye contact is going to be different. Here is very normal to have this contact when we have conversations, right? But in other cultures, as the Japanese, as I mentioned, maybe it's not, right? It's not normal, and people don't do that. So subsurface culture varies. Personal space, facial expressions, body language, they are different and they vary from culture to culture. Conversation patterns, concepts of time, behavior-based, unspoken rules of social interaction. Rules vary across cultures. And then we have the deep culture. And this is what we can see easily. It's difficult, right, to identify. And if we don't know about the culture, of course, we will not know how to identify these patterns, for sure. Deep culture show us the right and normal ways to do something in a place. And this is the perspective that I show in the 3P element. They are unconscious values and attitudes that we have as a culture. So we behave differently. Nature of friendship, gender roles, concepts of food, they are more difficult to identify. Preferences, right? Preferences for competition and cooperation, they are different. Some examples that we can use is like the way we raise children. It's normal for us to live with our parents until we get married, for example. But in other cultures, of course not. Some children sleep with their parents in the same bed, in some cultures, and that's natural and it's normal, but for some others, it's not. So all that attitudes, things that we consider normal, are part of the deep culture. So in order to identify the deep culture, we have to think deeply as well. And we can use this kind of activities with our students. We can make them think deeply. And this is the template that you can use in your classroom. This is presented by Harold Franks. And this is the cultural iceberg. What we can do is to just draw a pyramid or give the students a template. No problem. Students can work in groups and they can think about their own culture first. As a homework, you can give them research in order to compare with other cultures. So what they are writing is like this. First, they are talking Well, they are exchanging, like they can work in groups. What I did is to group students and make them groups to share, right? They can brainstorm. They are writing about the surface culture. Of course, they are including things that they can see, right? The holiday traditions, right? Customs, food. They can give examples. They can place pictures. They can use their imagination. Then we have the surface culture. They have to think more in this section because they have to think about conversational patterns, personal space, as I mentioned previously. And they have to go deep, the deep culture. Here, they can mention our social practices, so wedding traditions, for example, values, beliefs, they differ from other cultures. We can use this template to practice and to raise awareness with our students. They can think about us, right, and the way we live. And after they complete this template, they can research about other cultures. As they are learning English, we can ask them to research about the US culture or British culture or any other that maybe they are interested. This is the first activity that I have in order to raise our students' awareness about culture. And this would be a very fun activity because the students will share, right? And even they will see that they have differences, and that's what we are talking about in a moment, about microcultures. Even we belong to us, to the same society, we have different characteristics. So let's make in groups with students, they are sharing and they are completing the analogies here. They can research later and compare cultures, and then they can present later in our class. And here is where we can apply the 7 active listening techniques. So I suggest you to practice, right, to go deep. As I said, mentioned previously, students are unique, and even we share the same general culture, we have our own culture, and we can be part of many microcultures. Let me show you about microcultures. And here we have a quote. A microculture is an identifiable group of people who share a set of values, beliefs, and behaviors, and who possess a common history and a verbal and non-verbal symbol system that is similar to but systematically varies from the larger, often dominant culture. This means that even if we share a general culture, we have our own microcultures. We have our own microcultures. If we think the way we behave at home, and if we compare the way we are and behave at school, at the university, in our job, the ways are different. So they are the microcultures. We have different microcultures. We have, let's think about home. At home, we behave in a way. We have different traditions with our family, different ways to behave that can vary when we move to another place. And that's our microculture. We are part of many microcultures. And it's part of our identity. We belong to many microcultures, as I mentioned before. Well, we have a lot, depending. If we practice a sport and we go to the field and practice soccer, for example, we have microculture routines and some patterns that we call, we perform with those people. And at home, another one. Yeah, we can share hobbies, professions, religions, politics, etc. And per each, we have our microculture. Microcultures connect many different aspects of a person's identity. We like many things and we do many things as well. So they are our microcultures. We can have a lot of microcultures. In order to make our students share their microcultures, we can use the identities wheel. This is the second activity that we can use with our students. Generally, I use this activity the first day of classes because I want students to mention more things about them. And also, it helps us to introduce ourselves, to know each other, and it's a really nice way to know and go deeper. And they are talking about their identity. The identity wheel is a wheel. It's a diagram to identify all your identities. Everything you are, you can place here in this wheel, this diagram. We can establish our different roles we have in our microcultures. All of them are connected, of course. Here we are presenting our microcultures. Then we can use the identity wheel in class to raise our students' cultural awareness. With this activity, we're making our students think more about themselves. Not only that, the common one that, hello, I'm Anna, I'm a teacher, and I like pizza, right? Of course, depending on the level, we can adapt this, but for higher levels, it works very well. Even intermediate and higher levels, you can use it. Even our classroom, that is a microculture, we can apply here in this identity wheel. We're showing our preferences, our hobbies, our beliefs, the roles we have at home, school, work. Let me show you this. Here is the diagram. And it's very simple to create. We can show our students, we can explain them a little bit. And as you can see, this diagram has important information about us. We can ask our students to create their own diagram in order to share their roles and their microcultures they belong to. Here we have one example. I will show you two more. In the central part, they are mentioning what define them. Okay. Could be their names, could be a word that they can select, something that define them. And they are writing about their roles, as you can see here. When students create their identity wheel, they go deeper. They think about who they are. And they have to go farther. And that's the good thing. And that's what I like. They have to think more. They are like, oh, what else? Right? Maybe I never thought about this before. So they even discover themselves. And it's really good. Right? It's really good in order to interact. After they complete their diagram, their wheel, they can present to the class. And we can ask some questions about their wills. We can ask them, which roles did you choose? Well, I chose the role of daughter, mother, and student. We have many microcultures. So we are extracting, right, our identity from our microcultures. Which one are the most important to you? We can ask them. I consider that my professional identity is the most important one because I can develop more. I learn many things. But they can say many things. And also, we can answer, right? We can reply using the active listening techniques here, of course. Would you like to add more roles? Would you like to add more things to your wheel? We can ask them many questions. Which aspects or roles you chose for this assignment are the most important ones to you? Which are the ones that determine you? We can ask them many questions. This is a good way to interact. And as they are talking about them, of course, they will mention many things. What surprises you when you look at this list? What surprises you the most when you see your own will? Let's make them think about their own identity, their cultures, everything they are. Here I have some aspects that they can include in their will. In the central part, they can mention their name or, as I said before, something that identify them. Human, as we said in the previous example. Could be anything. There's no wrong answer here. And they can write about their identities. We have many identities. We belong to many groups. We do a lot of things. So many things that they can apply here. Family identity, origin. They can write about their religious identity, spiritual, their ethnicity, race. All of them are identities. Gender identity, age identity, sexual orientation. They can mention about their hobbies, their emotions, right? Their physical ability, any kind of ability they have. They can mention about their social, socioeconomic. They can write about their microcultures, right? All the roles they have. They can write about their studies, their professional, personal growth, even politics. Here I just show you some examples of the things that they can include in their diagrams. They are thinking deeply. They are thinking about themselves and they say, okay, what defines me? The first time I completed this diagram, it was quite complicated, and because maybe I didn't think about it previously so deeply. And this is the one I created for me. Based on my identity, it's very simple, but here I have an example. This is what I created, the open course. Anna, that's what I chose my name to identify, but you and your students can choose any other. Family identity, my roles in my family, I'm a daughter, I'm a sister, and I'm an out right now as well. Religious identity, right? I'm Catholic. Gender identity, woman. And of course, I can say more things when I report. That's what we have to ask our students. They write some things, but we have to ask them more. We have to ask them to say more. Sorry. A hobby identity, I travel, share with friends, relax. Professional identity, what I wrote is linguist, teacher. And that's what defines me. Of course, we have more because we belong to many microcultures, as I mentioned before. And we have many roles, many things. Maybe our students can write even more, can say more things. And that's what makes our, this activity very rich. I suggest you to use it with your students. And this is going to raise our students' cultural awareness. The first, they have to think about their own culture, our own culture, and later they can compare with other cultures, of course. And it's going to be easier, for sure. Great. So, yeah, that is, thank you so much. As a conclusion, I can say that we have to use active listening techniques in order to engage our students, motivate them as well to say more. Now that we are going back to face-to-face classes, students have to practice more speaking. Maybe they were very shy and they didn't mention many things during the online classes. So it's our opportunity to connect with them, make them say more and more. And we can apply the techniques here. Oh, yeah, nah, it sounds really interesting. Can you tell me more? Something similar happened to me, right? That's a good way to connect. We can offer alternatives, see the emotional side, make them feel comfortable, secure, because as they are learning, they are afraid to make mistakes. So give them the confidence. And of course, right, apply cultural awareness and microculture activities to raise awareness about our own culture in order to move to another one. That's what I prepare for you. Thank you so much. I'm not sure if you have any kind of comment or question.
Well, dear Anita, there was a question. Rosie Angie asked, so do the microcultures have to be with what we call tribus urbanas in our context?
Yes, right. As we are part of many activities, we have many roles, we do many things, and of course, right, they could be these tribus urbanas. We belong to many.
All right. Well, there are some comments. Thank you. It was a great presentation. Thank you. Good examples. I will practice them. Thank you. Teacher Wendy says, I think it is important for them to be aware of their own identity. Thank you for the example. There's a question here. Can the identity will be used in pre-task or post-task activities? It seems there's been a problem. Our presenter is frozen for some reason. There's some more comments. Very nice, thank you. Thank you so much for the great ideas. I put it into practice. Nice presentation, thank you. Oh, Anita, there, you're back. Sorry, there was a question. Can the identity will be used in pre-task or post-task activities?
Yes, as I mentioned, it's possible. We have some activities, some units in our books that refer to culture. So we can use these activities before in order to make students think about their own culture and then share and research more about the other cultures. It's possible. It is easy.
All right, yes. There are some more comments. Nice presentation. Thank you so much. Thanks so much. Great ideas to put into practice. I completely agree with Fernando. It was a great session. Thank you, Anita, for your time. And I hope to see you again in another conference. Thank you. And thank you everyone for attending. Thank you. Do not forget to mark your attendance, please. Goodbye, everyone. The next presentation will begin in about 5 minutes. Thank you, Anita.
Thank you.